Welcome back, everybody. I hope you had a fantastic lunch. To introduce our next session, I have the great privilege of welcoming the Honourable Ben Franklin, MLC, President of the Legislative Council, having been elected in May this year. Under the previous government, Mr. Franklin served as Minister for the Arts, Minister for Aboriginal Affairs, Minister for Tourism, and Minister for Regional Youth. He's a passionate advocate for the arts, the regions, and for representative democracy, and we are privileged to be working under his guidance and under that of the Clerk as they formulate the program for our bicentenary celebrations. Please join me in welcoming President Ben Franklin.
Well, thank you very much, Janelle, and welcome back from what I hope was a sustaining and delightful lunch. But for our next session, we'll be considering the early Legislative Council in the context of the shifting and emerging political tapestry of the 1820s into which it was established. We'll explore the unique political and public culture in which distinctive factions were already emerging, with the colony on the cusp of developing a popular press and on the brink of a period of sustained political contention. To guide us on an exploration of this political landscape, I have the pleasure to introduce Professor Frank Bongiorno AM. Frank is a Professor of History at the Australian National University and President of the Australian Historical Association. His latest book is Dreamers and Schemers, A Political History of Australia. Frank is a Fellow of the Royal Historical Society, the Academy of the Social Sciences in Australia, and the Australian Academy of the Humanities. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Frank Bongiorno.
Great, thank you so much, Mr. President. I would like to acknowledge the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation and pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging, as I would the Ngunnawal and Ngambri peoples of the Australian Capital Territory where I normally live and work. In September 1826, in a personal letter to British official Sir Robert Wilmot Horton, Chief Justice Forbes evoked the sense of a genuine polity, indeed a kind of public sphere, that had come into being, he thought, in recent years. The affairs of the colony have changed. They are so much changed that we are hardly the same body politic. The appointment first of a Supreme Court and then of a Legislative Council and afterwards of an Executive Council, the spreading of the government over a larger area, the frequent points of contact with the best informed of the inhabitants, and above all, the fairness and openness with which the affairs of the colony are now conducted have made something like a peaceful revolution in the place. I must add to the liberty of discussing the acts of government and public men in the journals of the colony has given the people an interest, a knowledge, an impetus, which it would have been hardy to foretell in the colony for the next generation. It seems like a very nice, pleasant place to live. It's notable, I think, though, that in his evocation of the emergence of a public sphere, Forbes credited three institutions to which his own career was closely tied: the Legislative Council, the Executive Council, and the Supreme Court. Now, given that he was, as we've already heard in a number of the papers, an architect of the 1823 legislation and became, in a way, the Legislative Council's de facto president in the very early period, Forbes was hardly disinterested in his early assessment that the council was, as he said, a wise measure, works marvellously well, and was rather liked by the public. We can better discern, I think, in Forbes's letters, a vision, I think, of representative government, a vision of a representative parliament, rather than its achievement and substance at this point in the 1820s. He understood, I think, that however well the members of the council performed and however conscientious they were in their duties, that it did lack a representative aspect. Now, what I want to do today, I mean, I think we've looked at this topic from a number of different perspectives, from a legal perspective, from the perspective perhaps of constitutional evolution. What I want to do here is to test the idea that the council was significant in shaping New South Wales into a new kind of polity of the kind, or political system of the kind that Forbes, I think, is evoking in that quotation. So the perspective is that of political history. And my argument is that it was not, and it was not intended to play that kind of part. The Legislative Council rather slipped pretty quietly into the political culture that was already taking a distinctive shape by 1824. I think this was one of David's themes. But that political culture was also changing very fast, and I want to try and capture a sense of that dynamism in the next few minutes. It was acquiring a sophistication and a complexity that could not adequately be served by the 1823 legislation. And I don't think could be by the 1828 legislation either, I might add. Now, the new body caused few ripples. The main game, as far as political history goes, political affairs, largely occurred elsewhere, at grand banquets and public meetings, in the courtroom and in legal documents, in petitions and newspapers, and at the governor's desk and dining table. The council's constitutional position didn't translate into a status as a major focus of either satisfaction or dissatisfaction. Rather, colonists with grievances tended to bypass it. John Eddy has evoked the flow of documents from the colonies to London in what he calls real politics that emerged in the 1820s. And I quote from him, "Emancipated convicts, the colonial-born, lawyers, merchants, pastoralists and farmers all had claims to make. Legal documents, the accounts of personal feuds, vengeful or frustrated tirades against administrators, long treatises on colonial conditions, and the constant cry for land, free rations, stock, appointments, convict labour, and other favours assailed the colonial office." You can sort of, you know, visualise that flow of paper in those ships. The Legislative Council itself, I'd argue, was peripheral to the great public movements of the era, which locally, so moving beyond what John Eddy's talking about there, locally focused a sense of grievance on the person of the governor, his relatives and officials. Now, the British theorist Bernard Crick defined politics, and I quote, "as the activity by which differing interests within a given unit of rule are conciliated by giving them a share of power in proportion to their importance to the welfare and survival of the whole community. It involves conciliation and compromise," and again I quote, "a way of ruling in divided societies without undue violence." I mean, one description of this kind of idea is that it allows those, a minority who were defeated, if you like, whether it's in a parliamentary vote or at an election, to live with the majority who've defeated them. But it does involve, obviously, the exercise of power. Divided societies tend to be unequal societies. In New South Wales of the 1820s, a settler colonial society, whites exercised more power than Indigenous people. Men had more power than women. The propertied had more power than the poor. The free had more power than the freed, generally speaking. I mean, these are all generalisations. This was a dynamic society, of course, in which the cross-cutting of identities was shaping and reshaping political life. We're familiar with the power that could be exerted by rich emancipists, for instance. We also need to keep in mind that across large parts of what was then New South Wales, essentially all of Eastern Australia, many First Peoples continued their lives much as they had before the British invasion. The traditional economies, cultures and societies and their accustomed means of decision-making, their political and legal order, remained intact. So there's a deep time history of politics in this state and in this country in which First Nations peoples had institutions and law by which they ruled their own societies, including assemblies that look rather deliberative from the settler accounts that we have of them. They look like parliaments in a way. These political systems were disrupted and sometimes destroyed by colonisation, along with other aspects of Indigenous society. But First Peoples also drew on them in responding to the presence of invaders in their lands, on deliberating on whether to fight or to negotiate, to avenge or to forbear, to stay clear or to come into cities, towns and settlements. As Lisa Ford has shown, there was a de facto acceptance by the British newcomers of the continuity of Indigenous law and therefore of First Nations sovereignty. In the earliest interactions of Arthur Phillip and the Sydney colonists with the Eora, the Gadigal, the Bidjigal, and their leaders, such as Bennelong, Colby, Pemulwuy, political encounter was a part of a wider cultural encounter, with old and new sovereignties perhaps best thought of as entangled rather than a blanket kind of overlaying, one blanket overlaying another one. But as the invaders occupied greater tracts of territory on which to grow their crops and to run their sheep, British imperial government claimed a more absolute sovereignty over both peoples and lands. The status of Aboriginal resistance as warfare, and therefore as fundamentally political rather than criminal or savage or barbaric, to return to the offensive language of that era, all of that became more ambiguous. The political aspects of it became more ambiguous in the eyes of colonial political authority as time passed. Now, the establishment of the Legislative Council was an aspect of this project of creating a rational and uniform imperial order founded, I think, on a more secure and settled territorial sovereignty. It was not created to make space for political expression or struggle. Rather, as David explained in previous paper, it was the result of a rising anxiety about the legal status of the existing order, concerns that magnified during the Macquarie era and would be papered over with temporary remedies of one sort or another, such as acts of indemnity, which basically indemnified the governor, passed by Westminster. A particular concern was that the governor would be sued by levying taxes without parliamentary authority. There'd been many critics of the colony's legal basis, going all the way back to John MacArthur in the very early years of the 19th century, but Jeremy Bentham was the most famous and influential. As Anne Brun and Ernst suggested, Bentham's view was that the governor had power only over some categories of persons, such as convicts, officers, soldiers, marines and sailors, but not over civil servants, former convicts and free settlers. As Bentham put it, I should have shown you that. There's Bennelong. There's a quote from Bentham, and I won't read the whole quotation there. The whole quotation will give you a very good indication, I suppose, of why John Stuart Mill devotes a part of his autobiography to explaining that Jeremy Bentham wasn't a very good prose writer. But the basic idea is captured in this brief version. The successive governors of New South Wales have for these 14 years past been exercising legislative power without any authority from Parliament, and either without any authority at all from anybody, or at most without any authority but from the King. So Bentham is an influential critic of the legal basis of New South Wales. He believed that in promulgating regulations, the governor had created offences that did not exist in English law, and that the colonial courts were not therefore competent to deliberate on. So here was an alarming account of both the legislative and judicial functions, or foundations, I should say, of New South Wales. Now, the early authoritarianism of a political order which gave the governor, at least in theory, something like untrammelled power, was a product of a swing away from more representative forms of rule in the wake of the American Revolution. And Stephen Garton, in an early session yesterday, talked about some of those examples of North American councils and assemblies, going right back to the 17th century. Authoritarian rule had seemed especially apposite in a penal colony which called for strong executive governments. And it was reinforced by the outbreak of revolution in Europe, which especially from 1793 provoked counter-revolutionary reaction in Britain. Still, the power bestowed on governors provoked nagging questions about constitutionality. The American War of Independence was fought in part over the question of taxation without representation. So in New South Wales, this imperial despotism in miniature, as it's been called by one imperial historian, it did fit the times, an era of revolution and counter-revolution, warfare, but arguably not the identity of a British people who proclaim proudly that they never will be slaves. Now, the political history of early New South Wales disclosed many of these kinds of tensions. The Second Fleet brought with it news of revolution in France, the execution of the King and Queen in 1793, inaugurated a more intense fear among authorities of revolt, rebellion, revolution. Friends of Liberty, as they were called, would be transported to the colonies, five of the six Scottish martyrs, Jacobins in sympathy with the French Revolution, arrived in Sydney as colonists. They were convicts. The best known of them, Maurice Margaro, claimed to have been in Paris at the time of the storming of the Bastille in 1789 and was soon after that a member of the famous London Corresponding Society, sometimes considered the first English working class political organisation. The authorities regarded Margaro's home in Sydney as a hothouse of sedition. Revolutionary ideas extended beyond such gentlemanly prisoners, however. Thomas Paine's Rights of Man, the book that more than any other inspired the revolutionary ardour of that era, was being read by officers in New South Wales, and his notoriety hung over the early history of the colony. It was the arrival of convicts following the uprising of the United Irishmen in 1798 that brought a more intense fear again. There were several conspiracies uncovered by the authorities between 1800 and 1803, and one shipboard mutiny that had resulted in the killing of 14 convicts. That was followed in March 1804 by the better known rebellion of about 200 convicts working at Castle Hill. Scholarship on the uprising used to play down its ideological dimensions, but the work of recent decades indicates that it's better considered an uprising of the United Irishmen abroad, inspired by the potent combination of Britain's renewal of war with Napoleonic France in March 1803 and a failed uprising in Dublin staged by Robert Emmet in July 1803. The rebels embraced a modified version of the Irish revolutionary slogan, death or liberty, to which they added, and a ship to take us home. The badly organised affair, predictably, ended in a bloodbath, but it's a reminder, I think, of the place of New South Wales, and this is, again, was Stephen's theme yesterday, the place of New South Wales in a European imperial order that was being rocked by revolution. I mean, these events, remember, were contemporaneous with the Haitian Revolution, beginning with the uprising of slaves in 1791 and, of course, leading to the massacre of thousands of European inhabitants of that island and those loyal to them in 1804, the very same year as Castle Hill, followed by Haiti's independence. It's surely no wonder that authorities in New South Wales inclined towards harshness in their dealings with rebellious or potentially rebellious convicts, especially when they were Irish. The Spithead and Nore naval mutinies of 1797 had also exposed the British Empire's vulnerabilities in an age of revolution. War and fear are often bedfellows, and the whole history of early New South Wales and Van Diemen's Land occurred against the background of Britain's war with France, which was only rarely interrupted before Waterloo in 1815. Now, resistance to the governor's authority in New South Wales came primarily from military officers, or in the case of John MacArthur, an ex-officer engaged in commerce, pastoralism and meddling. In the absence of an assembly, a free press or popular politics in the early years, resistance to the governor's authority depended on other means and opportunities. In a small, intimate community, the social snub could be readily deployed. In this way, of course, women were drawn into the colony's factional politics. They were drawn in all sorts of other ways as well. In 1801, through the courts, for instance, in 1801, MacArthur, in dispute with Governor King, promoted a boycott of Government House among the officers. When King, to test the waters, sent out an invitation to civil and military officers for a function, excluding only MacArthur, he received acceptances from all but four. And I quote from King, "who were so uncivil as to not send me any answer until I sent for it, when they all refused. I could no longer be in doubt who were and who were not the adherents of Captain MacArthur. So you can see how this symbolic politics, as face-to-face, intimate politics works in early New South Wales. You didn't need a parliament or an assembly for these things to play out. A government's opponents could also anonymously circulate printed libels in the form of a ribald verse called pipes. King was the target of several of these in 1803 during his feud with the officers. He accused one Lieutenant Hobby of responsibility for what's called anticipation or birthday ode. And these are just four lines from a rather long poem, for want of a better word, verse, I suspect would be more accurate, of surgeons, civilians and men of the law and other descriptions with many a flaw. The great king presided as chief of the clan, a wicked, oppressive, notorious man. The courtroom, as we've heard, was also favoured as a site for prosecuting factional struggles, as Herbert Vere Evatt, our Chief Justices, showed so vividly in his book Rum Rebellion. A court-martial, criminal trial or civil hearing could in this manner become the occasion for the pursuit of a feud or the staging of a contest. Military officers dominated all of them and could easily stage a trial of strength with the governor. A powerful, skilled and determined litigant or accused might use the court as a most convenient political arena. MacArthur, a turbulent former officer and the colony's richest man, used a series of cases between 1806 and 1808 in just this way to pursue his quarrels with Governor William Bligh. And there's a mass of literature, of course, on the Bligh Rebellion itself, his eventual overthrow in January 1808. But the most convincing interpretation, I think, of recent years has moved beyond the idea that this was a class struggle between small settlers and wealthy merchants, with Bligh as a kind of defender of the common people, which was the basic argument that Evatt put back in the 1930s. The episode instead needs to be seen in the context of the broader history of political authority and challenges to it within Great Britain and its empire, as well as against a background of intense debate around political ideas, including those of Bentham that I've just been discussing. MacArthur and the officers were influenced by Whiggish ideas of freedom, which had been used to justify the overthrow of James II in the Glorious Revolution of 1688, and which had also seen governors deposed in the northern American colonies. Bligh had proposed to demolish buildings that had been built on government lands, a plan from which the officers stood to lose materially. They saw in such an arbitrary threat to property rights an offence that went to the heart of their understanding of the distinction between freedom and tyranny. It's also striking, I think, that this affair was haunted by the spectre of popular revolution, or at the very least, it gave a key figure in it an excuse that he could use for his behaviour when he was later called to account for it. Major George Johnson later testified that if rebellious officers had been arrested, the military would have joined in insurrection with the people. Now, Johnson may have been desperately fictionalising and fantasising here, but he would surely not have raised such an argument, and he did so on more than one occasion, if he thought that the authorities at home would not have been receptive to it at this time, you know, in the early years of that century, with the war with France still raging. Now, the point of the discussion so far has been to give something of a prehistory of the 1823 legislation and the subsequent formation of the Legislative Council. I won't be talking about the Supreme Court here. The colony was not lacking in a political culture. Party or factional struggle was executed by the means offered, sometimes adapting aspects of inherited British constitutionalism. Violence, I think, was a central aspect of this culture, something it's easy to lose sight of, even as the colony moved into the 1820s and 1830s towards an order in which we can observe the origins of, you know, some of our modern political arrangements. Official treatment of convicts arguably became more severe. The Legislative Council was not designed as an institution that would allow the incarcerated to expose injustices against them, and nor was it expected to play any role in representing the emancipist class. Even the young William Wentworth, sometimes misleadingly treated as a leader or spokesperson of the emerging group of former convicts, trod very carefully around how such people might be incorporated in a system of representative government. Writing from London in 1819 in a statistical, historical and political description of the colony of New South Wales and its dependent settlements in Van Diemen's Land, they always had such long titles, didn't they? Wentworth called for trial by a civilian jury, an elective legislative assembly and a nominated council. But he tiptoed cautiously around the issue of emancipist participation in those arrangements. Any former convict who had not reoffended after transportation and who now possessed 500 acres or more should qualify to serve in an assembly, and then much lower levels of property should be sufficient to vote. But again, he insisted that former convicts must not have reoffended. So he was a property franchise that recognised the respectable propertied emancipists as entitled to political rights alongside freemen, but it's hardly, it's not really democratic, is it? It's not a vision of a radical democracy by any stretch. The design of the early Legislative Council indicates that it was more a fig leaf for the governor than a place where such demands for wider civil freedoms might be advanced. Big, as we've heard, had not even recommended the formation of such a body in his report on the colony, and it had only been added at the last minute to the New South Wales Bill. The historian ACV Melbourne commented that it was created, and I quote, merely for purposes of administrative convenience. And again, quoting, it was thought to be neither wise nor necessary to admit the influence of public opinion to a share in legislation in New South Wales. It initially had only 5 members or officials. The Sydney Gazette, the mouthpiece for the government, applauded this limitation, asserting that it, and I quote, would have been extremely difficult to have selected any 2 gentlemen from the agricultural and commercial interests as members of the Legislative Council without perhaps creating an invidious distinction. There's perhaps an early tall poppy syndrome. The British government, however, regarded this original and narrow composition of the Legislative Council as only a temporary measure. It was reconstituted in 1825 to comprise 4 official and 3 non-official members. The officials also joined a new executive council. In 1829, its size increased again to between 10 and 15 members. So here was the beginning, I suppose, of a parliament that would at least represent the opinions of the propertied and the respectable, the merchant and the landowner. But the governor, of course, still held enormous sway. The council met in camera, and its members took an oath of secrecy until the 1828 changes. Only the governor could initiate legislation, and he could override a council vote in some circumstances, as Brett Walker explained yesterday. Forbes, as we've seen, believed the council did good work, but even he could see its inadequacies in an increasingly complex colony. Writing to Wilmot Horton in September 1827, he reported that it had met for a few days the previous May, but neither for many months either before or afterwards. Probably reflected in some of the figures that David produced, I think, in terms of legislation. The Executive Council, established in 1825, did not meet more often. Indeed, Forbes joked that it ought to be called the Execution Council, since it only met to deliberate on condemned felons. Government in the Darling era was by what we would now call a kitchen cabinet, which Forbes believed comprised self-interested yes-men. The colony, he felt, had outgrown its institutions. A house of assembly was needed, or else the voice of the public would seek other channels, such as the press and parliament in Britain. Forbes's earlier optimism about the council's performance and reputation seemed to have evaporated. So what had changed? Firstly, Forbes himself had spent time away from the Legislative Council's affairs at Bathurst during a period of illness. In his absence, by his account, the Legislative Council ground to a halt. The Bank of New South Wales became embarrassed, and political intrigue and division overtook the council's affairs. There was also the fall of the not very businesslike Governor Brisbane, accompanied by intense factional politics between the MacArthur family and exclusives on one hand and Wentworth and his allies on the other. Each had offered the departing Governor Brisbane a banquet in his honour. It was eventually Wentworth's that was left standing, and the young lawyer did not miss the opportunity to advocate trial by jury and a representative assembly, which Brisbane compliantly and helpfully agreed the colony was now ready for. He could say that because he was leaving. Public events of this kind, with their carefully designed choreography, band music, loyal toasts and visual spectacle, Augustus Earle was hired to decorate the room, were the stage on which the colony's political life was now being acted out. Press coverage, now contained in titles such as The Australian and Monitor, as well as the older Gazette, provided record and commentary, building a wider sense of political community and partisan allegiance. It was the Suds and Thompson affair that did most to expose the inadequacy of the council's arrangements. The Legislative Council passed a law allowing the governor to withdraw convicts from penal settlements with the idea of either they're working in irons if they'd behave badly or being assigned to a settler for service if their conduct had been good. It was this law that came into play in the case of what had begun as a seemingly insignificant crime. Two soldiers in September 1826, Suds and Thompson, were arrested for stealing some cloth from a Sydney shop. They admitted having done so to get out of the army and received 7 years' transportation. But then Darling, concerned about army discipline at a time when there'd been several similar cases, decided to make an example of them and intervened to override this original sentence. He interpreted the new law to mean that he could change a sentence of transportation to labour in irons on the roads. The men were to be subjected to a humiliating ceremonial punishment and then to hard labour before being returned to their regiment. All might have been well for the administration, except that Suds died a few days after being paraded before the regiment in chains, probably from a virus doing the rounds of Sydney. Forbes believed Darling had erred in law, but that the men had deserved their punishment. Now, this incident translated into a scandal when the Australian, having previously displayed little concern about the treatment of the men, made it the basis of a campaign against Darling. The heavy chains evoked images of torture and slavery, and Darling was unlucky in the timing of the affair with the anti-slavery movement ascendant at home, the 1823 Act due to expire, and reformers on the lookout for means by which they could advance an elective assembly and trial by jury. The campaign against the governor, with Wentworth preparing a case for impeachment, damaged Darling's reputation and in fact led to his eventual return to London. Wentworth and his allies, of course, led the wild public rejoicing that followed. Well, there's a famous piece of propaganda in the Suds and Thompson case. So to conclude, Wentworth called the Legislative Council a wretched mongrel substitute. That's probably a harsh judgment, but it reflects the reality that it met the colony's legal requirements, more or less, but not its political requirements. Nor did it reflect the colony's growing complexity and sophistication. The council that began meeting here in Macquarie Street from 1829 would eventually prove to be different with its larger size and fine balance of officials and non-officials. The respectful attitude that Governor Burke adopted towards even the manoeuvrings of his political opponents on the council in the 1830s enhanced its importance as a place of deliberation and a site of politics. In such ways, while the Legislative Council did not initially play a transformative part in the colony's political life, it would come to have a more influential role even before it became partly elected in 1843. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Professor. I think you'll all agree that that was quite a fascinating set of insights. I was mildly concerned when we started on the historical peripheral relevance of the Legislative Council that that's where we were going to end. But I took great heart in your final comments, which showed the clearly central place of the Legislative Council in society in New South Wales today. But now, of course, we're delighted to take questions from the audience for our esteemed Professor Bongiorno. It is quite difficult to see up here, but do we have any questions? We only have about 7 minutes for questions, so I'm sure that we can find a couple. There we are. Okay. Indeed.
Yeah, thanks, Frank. I did appreciate and was pleased to hear about the longer trajectory of dissent and opposition within the colony, and you know, it's tracing back to a bigger picture. So, but you know, my idea was always that the failure of this act to satisfy those demands really accentuated. So dissent really ramps up in the 1820s. Do you think in the wake of this act? And is it a different? To what extent is it a different sort of dissent than what you see, you know, tracing back to the early 1800s and the 1810s? Is it fundamentally different?
Yeah, I think it is. I mean, I'd sort of call it the rise of a popular politics in the 1820s. And I mean, it's not a mass politics in the way that, you know, we might understand that today, which I think has some years to wait. And it's not really a democratic politics either. I mean, the term democracy is pretty, I think, anachronistic for much of what we're talking about in the 1820s. I mean, it's a form of Whiggish politics, I'd say, in terms of, you know, what Wentworth's up to. But it is a popular politics in the sense it's, you know, you've got political leaders who are using a range of fora deploy bodies, to deploy noise, to deploy spectacle against political authority in ways that I don't think we see much of before the 1820s. And there's a kind of program sitting behind it, I guess, is the other point, which, you know, Wentworth has kind of outlined in that 1819 publication. But at that point, there's no movement behind those sorts of ideas. I mean, there's various forms of petitioning going on where some of these issues, like trial by jury and so on, are being raised. But there's no movement behind it. But by the time we get to certainly about the mid-1820s, I think the landscape has changed. I think that you do have something that I think we can call a kind of popular politics, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's still a very small face-to-face society. And, yeah, the charismatic leadership of a figure like Wentworth, I think, is a part of that story. Yeah, yeah.
And if I take that up about Wentworth, it seems to me with Wentworth in London when the 1823 Act goes through, his decision with Wardell to bring a printing press, to what extent do you feel that this is quite a staged process? That the press and the way in which they use the press, the so-called freedom of the press, but really just challenging. And Brisbane goes along with it, you know. I mean, Wentworth writes and say, can we have income? Can we have the government advertising? You know, it's no real secret, despite the myth that this is done without permission. So it seems to me that the role of the press in generating your political environment is something important, and Wentworth gets a lot of it, but what about Wardell?
Yeah, and in fact, not just Brisbane. I think Darling's pretty complacent about it too, isn't he, initially? I mean, we associate Darling with that, you know, obviously the jailing of E.S. Hall and all that sort of stuff, but he doesn't seem unduly concerned initially either. I mean, I think, obviously, this is a period where the power of the printed word, becoming very much a part of emerging political cultures in Britain and Europe. And so it's hardly surprising that Wentworth, having spent so much time in both Britain and Europe, during that juncture, would, you know, come back to New South Wales with political ambitions and on the make, more generally, as a lawyer, that, you know, he sees the importance and value. In fact, he sees it's essential that you have some sort of mouthpiece where you can create a sense of kind of horizontal comradeship, a sense of political community, which is really what the press does. It allows you to forge those kinds of identities and alliances that are, I guess, a more face-to-face society, a more informal society, a society based, you know, to go back to some of the work that Alan Atkinson has done, a society where the vocal and the oral and the verbal are more important. To move away from that is, I think, to create a different form of politics. And I think that's also a part of the novelty of what's happening in the 1820s. Yeah.
Thank you. We'll now go to one of my colleagues, Jeremy Buckingham.
Thank you, Mr. President. Professor, in the month preceding the first meeting of the New South Wales Legislative Council, there'd been a declaration of martial law in Bathurst. And then if you look at the minutes of the first Legislative Council, the first thing they did was appoint William Stewart. who then with then and then they dealt with the Rossi reports into the creation of a police force, and Stuart actually created the New South Wales Police. Could you reflect on that? What, like, how did the colony feel about the declaration of martial law? Did they feel under threat from the Wiradjuri? And why, in such a militarised society, was there a need to actually create another form of order in the form of the New South Wales Mounted Police?
Yes, I mean, there is, during the Governor Brisbane period, the Brisbane era, an upsurge of violence. I mean, it's been an issue since the 1790s, of course. But yes, the declaration of martial law, and it's very much a part of the scenario we're talking about here. Governors are effectively, in this era, military leaders. You know, we've seen the transition really from naval figures to army figures, which I think is bound up in that transformation, a sense that this is a colony that's effectively now engaged in a kind of territorial occupation that really wasn't an aspect of the very early period. I mean, the early period, there's a sense that you're kind of that some sort of coexistence is possible, but once you start sending sheep, you know, over the mountains and to occupy the plains in the west and elsewhere, north, south, it's a different sort of scenario. And yet, when we talk about the early history of the Legislative Council, we're talking about that very period, the assertion, I guess, of a much more ambitious kind of sovereignty that accompanies, you know, the coming of colonial capitalism, really, in its you know, that form that was authorised and encouraged in the big reports. Yeah.
Thank you. You've got time for one more question in the centre there.
Do you have any feel as to how much Darling was hampered by having two particularly incompetent attorneys general, Sax Bannister and Baxter? They were hopeless, contrasted with Wentworth and Wardell. And he just could not have been getting any sound legal advice, let alone courageous prosecution of the government interest.
Yeah, David's been talking about this and would know a great deal more than... Forbes's letters to Wilmot Horton are scathing, increasingly scathing about Sax Bannister. He believed he was almost deliberately... In fact, I think he was almost, if he doubted, he could be as incompetent as he seemed. That he was actually deliberately doing what he was doing to undermine the governor was the sort of sense you get from that correspondence. But yeah, I mean, the governors, yes, they're reliant on officials, and they're in a very isolated position within colonial society. And in a way, the council, I don't know, it'd be interesting to think about this. I mean, does the council mitigate that sense of isolation? Does it give them, you know, increasingly kind of other forms of advice, alternative forms of advice, I guess, to those you described to lean on? And so in a sense, it perhaps does begin to break down that powerful sense of isolation that's such an important theme in the early history of the colony. But they're still heavily dependent on their officials, who of course are you know, ex officio members of all these bodies as well. But yeah, I wonder if by the time we get to, I suppose it's the third iteration, isn't it, of the council in the late 1820s, whether life is becoming a bit easier in some ways for governors, because they're not quite as isolated, perhaps, or dependent on their officials. I mean, Burke obviously had plenty of problems with his officials, some of them. But on the other hand, he also was able to cultivate allies, I think, perhaps more easily than maybe Brisbane and Darling were. Would that be true? Yeah.
All right. Well, unfortunately, we're out of time for this session. Can I thank all of those who've shared your questions with us? And most importantly, can I ask you to all show your appreciation to Professor Frank Bongiorno for a very simple session.